Those are the announcements. We come now to reflect upon the passage that we read from 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 37 to 43. It comes from a very long passage, the text of Solomon's prayer of dedication for the temple. And so we're not enabled with our brevity of time to place it entirely in its context, but we can derive much from the passage and very briefly relate it to some other aspects of the prayer. It is a beautiful prayer and very encouraging to the people of God as we apply it to our own circumstances. So our theme is that of the afflicted heart and the outstretched arm. We know the fallibility and sinfulness and neediness of the human heart, and God knows that, the afflicted heart, and he assures us of the outstretched arm upon which we may call continually. So let us pray before we consider. Lord, you know our circumstances and condition from moment to moment, how things fluctuate within us and how they fluctuate circumstantially. And you know the things that encourage us and move us to rejoicing, and you know those things that unsteady us and cause us concern and anxiety. We are grateful that as much as you know our hearts and you know them exhaustively, we can never know them, but you know them well and thoroughly. And we are glad that your outstretched arm can reach us and will touch us, especially in times of adversity and perplexity, uncertainty and trial. So, Lord, confirm these truths in our heart. Your control over our heart, your direction of it, is continuous as your children, and your government over all events, and your arranging them for the well-being of your children no matter what occurs, is a certainty of Holy Scripture. So bless us, O Lord, as we contemplate these truths. May we be candid with you in those moments that we encounter you, and may you be gracious to us, not according to our deserts, but your infinite mercy. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So this passage brings to our attention the afflicted human heart and the outstretched arm of the Lord. And that is what is reassuring, because our hearts are often afflicted, and it is good to know that the Lord is at the ready to comfort us and direct our lives. Now, we don't say this glibly, because we know that sometimes prolonged trials are ordained for the people of God. And we don't glibly assure people of God's immediate deliverance or even of complete deliverance. What we can say is that God takes account of our circumstances, that he will deliver ultimately, and he will give his people endurance and times of relief and various kinds of consolation in the midst of adversity. So this beautiful prayer of Solomon, which was prayed principally for Israel, with the opening of the temple in Jerusalem, which signifies the presence of God with his people, it symbolizes the presence. Solomon doesn't believe that God dwells there exclusively. He keeps reiterating the conviction that God is in heaven, but he does impart his presence to his people on earth, and the temple is the pledge of that. Israel's failure in due course was that they put their confidence in the temple and not in God. And it's the same for us. We can put our confidence in things that are external and not in those things that meet and address the heart. And I think that what is at the heart of this passage is Solomon's teaching that this is what matters. God's territory, God's residence concerning his people is the human heart. And that is what we present to the Lord, because that is what he reads, that is what he sees, that is what he judges us by, the heart. And that is how we determine to come to God, in a heartfelt fashion, with hearts open to his scrutiny, and hearts that we yield to him for his healing and for our wholeness. So we consider first verses 27 to 30, the temple of the presence of God. We have this exhortation, or at least Israel had the exhortation, to look to the temple and pray. It was there to generate conversation with and petition to God, to recognize that the temple declared that the Lord was with his people, available to them. The temple was the symbol of the present God, the listening God, the saving God. The people were to see beyond the material edifice to the God who did dwell in a special way in the temple, not exclusively. God is omnipresent. Heaven is his home, earth is his footstool, but he deigns to visit us and work among us and reveal himself in our world. And so we are taught by the construction of the temple and the promise of God that accompanies the building of that place, we are to see the Lord's nearness to his people. That is the progressive message of the entire scripture. You have that forecast and expectation of the nearness of God in the Old Testament. In the story of the birth of Jesus, we have that indication that his name is Emmanuel, God with us. And then from Pentecost on, we say that God is within us. Now, these three installments of the coming to us of the Lord are not clearly defined. Of course, the Old Testament people knew God within. Of course, they had experiences of the Spirit of God and intimations of the coming Saviour. But these are the three phases, as it were, of God drawing near to us in a very beautiful and special intimacy. He's on the way, there's his advent, he's with us in Christ, he is within us through the Spirit of Christ. And we have that closest association with the living God. And Christ takes on the role of the temple. He is the presence of God. And we become the temple of the Lord through the Spirit's indwelling. So you have the stage, the visible sign of God's presence, the evidence of God's presence in the Lord Jesus Christ, and then the sense and influence of the divine presence within us by the Holy Spirit. So this is the progress that we read of in Holy Scripture. And when the Israelite looked to the temple, that building beckoned the Israelite to repentance. We know it is inevitable that we stray, we wander from God, we sometimes immersed in forgetfulness of the Lord. There is sometimes a distance between ourselves and him. He never abandons us, but his presence is not a comfort to us. We're not conscious of his nearness. And so when that occurrence appears in our lives, we know that it is a cue to repentance. Repentance is a daily, moment-by-moment attitude from the people of God, a constant turning to the Lord, a constant awareness of perpetual forgiveness. The temple was to the Israelite the sign of repentance's necessity. External afflictions imposed upon the people of God awakened them to the afflictions of the heart. This word, Holy Scripture, this compilation of various books of various kinds and genre, these are the expressions of the divine heart. And God graciously declares himself to us. Now we are called upon to declare ourselves to God, not to disguise who we are, not to conceal what we are. Our hearts are open to the Lord. He knows, he sees. We are to concur with that reality. The heart and the afflictions of the heart are the root cause of all the afflictions that mankind experiences. It's not that we can specify particular sins in certain people's fortune and say that occurs because you have done such and such. We are speaking of the race en masse. The afflictions of the world are due to our breach with God. And they occur because of human sinfulness and departure from God, and they call us to a return to the Lord. They are means of awakening, warnings that we are wandering. And so the afflictions that occur outwardly refer to the ingrained, inherent tendencies to sin and evil within our nature. I can't say, because there's a drought anywhere or a storm, exactly what is the cause for that and who is blameworthy. It's just a general warning to all people. God knows the specificity, whether something is specifically addressed to certain people, persons, individuals for certain sins. We don't. We can't judge others. When we see misfortune in somebody's life, we can't accuse. Because these afflictions come for various reasons, not necessarily as corrective or as punishments, but to strengthen our faith and to draw us more dependently to the Lord. So we cannot judge these afflictions. But we can bring to the Lord the afflictions of our hearts. And if we are honest, they are many. The outward plagues indicate the inward plagues of human nature. And so we're urged to probe beyond that which is external, and to become aware of the heart's condition. Verse 38. And when a prayer or plea is made by any of your people, Israel, each one aware of the afflictions of his own heart and spreading out his hands toward his temple, this temple, then hear from heaven your dwelling place. We are to become aware of the heart's condition and to encounter the truth of our nature. Again, this fits in with the entire pastoral intent of the Lenten season. It's a time when we actually concentrate on the reality, the authenticity of our connection with God, our relation to him, our lives being affected by him. And God, who is in heaven, is saying, I'm not remote. I am with you, I am near you, my arms are outstretched towards you. Let's lock hands, let's embrace, let's deal with the afflictions of your heart. The Lord says this in kindness and not in cruelty. And so, when we are aware of our desperate need before God, we demonstrate that need with intensity and urgency in appeal to the Lord. Now, really crying out to God. Not everybody has the same temperament or the same intensity of feeling and experience. But I believe there come those crucial moments when we say it is imperative that I cry out to God. To spread out our hands and express the reaching of the heart to the Savior. You know, in the early church, what has now become the gesture of a priest, where there is that kind of conception of the ministry in certain liturgical churches, there's only one priest, the Lord Jesus Christ. But you'll often see, if you go to certain churches, what is recognized as the priestly gesture, the outreaching of the hands to God on behalf of the people. That was a common gesture or physical expression among early Christians. We reach out to you, Lord. It's a symbol of our yearning for him and our desire to approach him and be linked to him. We perform the yielding of the heart, known exhaustively to the searcher of hearts. Verse 39, then hear from heaven your dwelling place, forgive and act, deal with each man according to all he does, since you know his heart, brackets, for you alone know the hearts of all men. That's a stirring insight. I can cover up so many things if I wish. I can omit so many things in terms of self-knowledge, but the Lord knows everything thoroughly, exhaustively. So why is there any pretense in religion? And why do we feel we've got to somehow make ourselves fit and dress ourselves up to come to the Lord in a way that is false? He knows absolutely who we are and where we are, and so we can afford to be absolutely candid with him. And that makes us cry out, Lord, have mercy. And you'll see here that Solomon is saying, you know all men and deal with them according to each one as he does, since you know his heart. That doesn't mean that we're qualified by our works or our righteousness. It means that the heart is tested by the actions of the self, the possessor of the heart. The life discloses the content of the soul, which is either righteousness or wrong. Deal with my heart, Lord. There will be discomfort. There will be disturbance. There may be periods when one is distressed as what God has pointed out and put his finger on. But it is all for our ultimate health and well-being and our being perfected for fellowship with him for all eternity. The Lord surveys, the Lord sees, the Lord assesses with infallible accuracy. We are known. The fact engenders fear, caution, circumspection, all-round appraisal of our life before God. So this is God's dealing with the human heart. And then we see in the last portion of this passage, verses 41 to 43, something of the comprehensive mercy of God. That is what we can always look to, not presumptuously, but with confidence in the faithfulness and veracity of God's word. He is a merciful God, and that mercy is extensive and all-embracing. It is not to Israel alone. Verse 41. As for the foreigner who does not belong to your people Israel, but has come from a distant land because of your name, you see the foreigner too, the alien, those who do not yet know the Lord, are valuable to him. because of the possibility, the prospect of their being one to the kingdom. The foreigner, the alien, the God-seeking Gentile, who honors the name. The name is the expression we use for the person, the character, the qualities of God. The name is the person. And in order to know the person and to use the name aright, we are to be informed as to the character of the person, his mind, his thoughts, his actions, his purposes. The name represents the person of the self-revealed God. Those drawn by the outstretched arm, those who are aliens and foreigners to the covenant of God, the presence himself draws strangers to himself and into the society of his intimates. You see how early in Israel's history, and way before this, the people of God anticipated the outreach of the mercy of God to all the nations. Israel wasn't called to privilege exclusively, but to a mission, to a cause, to make God known to others. And it's the same for us who have been incorporated into the Israel of God. We're surrounded every day by foreigners and aliens to the kingdom. And we are to remember the divine concern for these folk. And if we can do nothing more for them than exhibit the kindness, the compassion, the righteousness of God and offer petitions on their behalf, we are to do so. It's a good practice sometimes when you're meeting people or people are milling around you in a crowd to fix your eyes on a pair of somebody else's eyes and even for a second or two crave that God will bless that person. I don't know them. I know nothing about them. I'm looking into those eyes, O Lord. Bless them. I think I can tell just briefly a little story that comes to mind. There was a gathering of Christian businessmen somewhere in America, I guess it was in Florida from the story I heard from a minister in Northern Ireland. And these men, during a time of leisure at this conference, were all relating to each other how they came to the knowledge of Christ. And one man said, "I was walking down a street in Sydney. Lots of people around, crowd rushing everywhere. And this little man came up to me and tapped me on the shoulder and said, 'Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ?' And before I could respond, he moved on." Now this sounds like a tall story, doesn't it? Another man from another country in another city said, "You know, the same thing happened to me." This little man, who represented a company and traveled the world, made a point of just touching people on the shoulder wherever he went. He didn't harass them. He didn't corner them. He didn't browbeat them. He just pointed them gently and briefly to Christ. And there were several men in that company that said, "The same incident occurred in my life. And here I am in a Christian businessman's fellowship." You see what God can accomplish by the slightest concern for those whom we perceive to be strangers to the Lord. So the Lord draws folk to himself from the length and breadth of the world, all types, including the unlikely. You know, I hear from sources, and we don't read this in the media, and I hope these reports are not exaggerated, but there are in these Middle Eastern countries in turmoil a considerable number of Muslims being drawn to Christ. They see the sturdiness and valor of the Christians. They hear elements of the gospel and they witness the faith and prayerfulness of believers and they are drawn into the kingdom. And I am told that this is not in insignificant numbers. Christians are suffering persecution in these lands, but their companies are growing, and people are being won to the Lord, strangers whom, humanly speaking, we would say will never come. You see, Jesus, in the Gospel of St. John, St. John chapter 6, says that those whom God has marked out for eternal life will be drawn to him. John chapter 6, verses 44 to 45. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. That is an extraordinary statement. But God himself draws his people to himself. And this is what Solomon is anticipating so long ago. God draws strangers to himself. We were strangers once, and now we know him. So here is enunciated the classic understanding of the divine purpose. Verse 43 in Kings. Then hear from heaven your dwelling place and do whatever the foreigner asks of you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your own people Israel, and may know that this house I have built bears your name. Universal provision of salvation is what God intends and what he is realizing in his work in this world. Universal salvation, not including every individual, but including all types of people, all nations will be drawn to the Lord through the word of the Lord. And in the time of Solomon, the temple bore the divine name and represented God's coming to earth in response to Solomon's question. Verse 27, which we didn't read, but will God really dwell on earth? Isn't that a suggestive question? Will God dwell on earth? I believe it's a powerful pointer to the truth, the prospect of the incarnation. The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you, how much less this temple I have built. Solomon says, can the Lord really dwell on earth? We know that he has, and we know that he still does through the Spirit of God. In the fullness of time and for us, there is one who has replaced the temple. The Lord Jesus Christ really did dwell as God upon earth. He bears the divine name. He extends the outstretched arm. He knows the affliction of our hearts. And we, in awareness of our sinfulness and frailties, stretch out our hands toward him, the only Savior of the world. Back to John's Gospel. I love the unity of Scripture and the explication of those things that are the Lord's secrets and only hinted at in the documents of the Old Covenant. But here in the New Testament, these things are made plain and expressed openly to us. And so John says in chapter 12, verse 32, this is Jesus, but I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Lord, draw us, we pray, and all whom we love and who are precious to us, draw many to yourself. Exert your grace among us and powerfully convince us of your nearness, your righteousness, your holiness, and your forgiveness. And this we pray in Jesus' name, the one who replaced the temple. Amen.